feel alive. We watch our worship on the screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. For the hurting in our city, would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now.
Welcome. Thank you that you have come today. We're thankful for those on Facebook and those able to come live. I guess I'm going to start with pray for me. I'm struggling with these sinuses. I don't have any other of the symptoms of COVID, so I don't think I have COVID, but that's why you'll see me very masked up. But I am really struggling. If I have a sneezing fit in the middle of all this, just know that I'm human. You already knew that, though. So I'm trying to do the best I can. This has been a couple weeks of really bad sinuses. I have this wonderful doctor. I don't think she ever watches, but Dr. Galante and I have a very good relationship. And I was telling her about my sinuses one time, and she goes, "Well, welcome to Northwest Indiana." And so I've never had this type of issue, but it seems like since I've been up here, I've struggled with it a little bit. Hopefully I won't lose my voice. I'll try my best not to do that. Excited about what's going on right now. A couple things coming up just to sort of put on your calendar. One of the things Jeanette and I have sort of put together this year for Lent season, which is coming sooner than you would imagine, is that we have this book that both of us have used and read in the past, which is called Draw the Circle. It's by Mark Batterson. And it's a 40-day devotional for prayer. And so for the 40 days, approximately the same 40 days as that people would observe Lent, we're going to read this book, and we're offering anybody that wants those. We bought 20 copies for $5 a piece, and it's a really good book. The author is Mark Batterson, and he also wrote Circle Maker, which if you've not read that, was one of the books that sort of was my formative understanding of prayer, between that and Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire. If you're looking for two books to read this winter and you've not read either Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire, or Circle Maker, they're great books. And they're great, and I never forget, we was reading Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire together, Jeanette and I. This is going to sound bad, but we were in bed together reading Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire. And I turned to her and said, "That's what we should be doing, is having a prayer meeting." And it's really what started us down the path in 2010 or 11 to become lay pastors of our prayer meeting at our other church. And It's a great book. It's both of them are will teach you a lot about prayer. We're going to use it for our prayer meeting for those weeks leading up to Good Friday. So that's one thing. In addition to that, Jeanette has wore this t-shirt often. It's on the front, it says insert prayer. On the back, it says stop, drop, and pray. And many people have talked about wanting a t-shirt or a hoodie. We're going to have a sign-up sheet next week that we'll get those made up. And it's from this series, Draw the Circle. So it'd be a good time if you ever wanted a hoodie with a prayer theme. When she wears her shirt out, she gets tons of comments all over the place. And so we'd be excited to be able to share those. We'll just charge whatever it costs us to make them. Not sure what that'll be, but we'll have a sign-up sheet next week, and you can sign up for that. People on Facebook can put comments in if they would want one. We just need your size, and then we'll tell you how much it's going to cost, and we'll figure that out later. So that's going on. The other thing that we're doing is that I announced this on Bible study. I wanted to announce it here. I have a chronological Bible that we have used in the past to read through the whole Bible in 1 year chronologically, which is a little bit different. Because like, for example, the New Testament, what is nice is as you're reading Acts, the epistles are inserted in through the story of Acts, so you know when they were written or approximate time. There's a commentary that goes with it that's built into the Bible, and I have two people so far that has signed up for it that has said that they would like to try to read all the way through the Bible. For one person, it'll be the first time they've ever read all the way through. Perhaps many of you have read all the way through, but if you have not, you are missing out on some of the most beautiful language, some of the greatest writing ever to be made to express so many thoughts that have changed the world. And often we miss out on Habakkuk or Haggai or some of those others unless we're reading all the way through. And there are some of you right now that are doing that. And so I just wanted to give this opportunity to read through the Bible together. Sometimes it's difficult. You get to Leviticus or Numbers or Deuteronomy, and some people, all good intentions at the beginning of the new year, say, I'm going to read all the way through, and they get there and they stall. But when you're reading with others, it helps. And we're going to start to use this in our Tuesday night Bible study at some point in the near future. I'm looking for a better price for the Bible. Right now it's like $15 a piece. And we're looking to see if we can find a better price. And after we get that started, but if you would let Jeanette or myself know that, hey, I'd be interested if you found the right price on one of those, that I would like one of those. And then we'll, on Tuesday nights, I'll speak on one of the 7 days that you read. And then on the Zoom meeting, we'll have greater discussion about the whole 7 days. So two things coming up that you can still be somewhat socially distant, but at the same time, I think fortify and strengthen your relationship with God. Obviously, we're still doing Bible study on Tuesday nights. We're in the book of Matthew. And we have prayer meeting on Wednesdays. I just want to say one other thing. I said this last week. We have so many people being so faithful with their tithe. Not only people that sit in the sanctuary, but people that are online. And I never thought that we would be blessed as well as we are for people that are hundreds of miles away from our church, that are willing to tithe and to contribute to this ministry. And I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for all that you do, and thank you for your faithfulness for those that have given from the beginning and have continued to give in some of the most difficult times we've had in a long time. And I just wanted to say thank you. The church thanks you. The ministry is better because of you. We were able to do some things with our media, with the way that we handle things, because you guys have been so faithful. And I just wanted to say thank you. Board meeting Thursday night at 7 p.m. And I think that's all the announcements. Someday you guys will get a great person to do announcements. your pastor's horrible at it. So, but maybe someday you'll find somebody like whatever that guy's name was on The Price is Right, with a good announcer's voice, or a woman or somebody that would be good at it, because I'm horrible at it. But what I'm excited about is that you don't have to hear announcements anymore. We can start to worship the Lord, and Debbie's going to lead us. Please stand.
Forever, God, you reign. Yours is of glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
By the lines where smiles have been, by the calluses of our labor, by the scars of our struggles, and by the strength of our prayers, all of which tell the story of who we are. Yet there's another mark, one that sets us apart from others and from who we once were. Unlike our physical marks, this mark can't be seen by human eyes, nor felt by human touch. Yet it's as present as the wind in the trees. For it is the mark of whose we are, rather than who we are. We are not our own. Our stories, our struggles, our victories, and our joys are all part of something larger, something greater than ourselves. This journey we call life is not about finding ourselves, so much as it is about losing ourselves and finding Him. As we move toward discovering Him, we become free to explore the depth and breadth of His love and His being. We realize that being a saved people doesn't mean we are a safe people, set upon a shelf to await His return. No, we're not safe, but rather we're sent from a comfortable place in society to the outcasts and the vulnerable, from an easy definition of friend and family to an ability to embrace the enemy with God's love, from inside the church walls to a world outside that needs Jesus. Our vision is to join God in His mission, to go wherever we must and do whatever it takes to penetrate the darkness and rescue the lost. We are set apart. We are marked. We are not our own. We are His.
We come to the time that we recognize the power of Jesus. We recognize the power of prayer. Before we get too far into our prayer time, I had a special thing that I wanted to do. There is a young lady getting ready to go to the hospital to have a procedure done. Her name is Bailey. And Jeanette has prepared this with my special anointing oil. And we used rubber gloves to make sure that it's protected well. We have it in a plastic bag now. It's amazing some of the things you have to do at COVID time. But this little handkerchief is something that we've sort of started doing, saying, hey, could we have some kind of token, some kind of reminder that would, if we gave it to somebody, they could hold on to and say, hey, I know that the church has been praying for me. And as the family looks at it, I hope they recognize that we have been praying for Bailey for a very long time, and that we have been praying for her, and we will continue to pray for her, because we believe in the power of prayer. We believe that if we call on His name, that He will hear us. And this handkerchief is not magical. There's no magical property in it that if you rub it on you or something, that it'll heal you. But we do many things in remembrance of Jesus. And for us, this is one of those ways that we do it in remembrance of Him. That we remember that He told us that we should anoint those that need anointing, that need healing, that need Him. And this is one of the ways that we wish to do that. I'm going to pray over this, and I'm going to ask you to pray from your seats, from your Facebook viewing device, wherever that is, and reaching out perhaps with your hand. I know it may seem a little silly, but because of COVID, we're not going to touch this. We're not going to get together and circle around it. With my sinuses, you probably don't want to be around me anyway. But I believe in the power of a church praying for those in need. Do you believe in that? Do you believe that God hears our prayers? That's all this represents. In a tangible way, all we're saying is that we believe and trust in Him. And so let us pray over this handkerchief, then we'll continue our prayer meeting. Our Heavenly Father, as others agree with me, Lord, we lift Bailey up to You right now. Lord, we don't know all the circumstances, we don't know all the solutions, but we know that You are the way maker, the healer, the great comforter, the great physician, and we know that we can trust in You and that You have promised us that we, if we lift her up to You, that You will hear those prayers. And Lord, right now, may this handkerchief represent our loving, our desire, our wish to lift her up to You, Lord, expecting and anticipating great things. Touch her. May the glory of God shine around her for what You are about to do. We are so thankful for what You are about to do, and we are excited to see You work. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There may be others that need prayer. I've heard that the Lewises are doing better. I think they're still, you know, dealing with it. They're sort of living, as all of us do at some point, sort of that life of Job, I think. Greg slipped and fell and required stitches. So above COVID, above everything else going on, they now got somebody in their family with stitches in their leg. There's so many people right now that I've spoken to and that I haven't spoken to that are feeling isolated, feeling abandoned, feel like nobody cares. And God cares. I care. You care. And I've been praying to God that He gives us ways to help each other through this time. If the church has no other purpose, it is that fellowship to be able to walk through the worst adversities in our lives and know that not only is God there, not only is Jesus there, but those that follow Him will be there also. And I'm so thankful for that. If you're online, if you will put, you know, any prayer requests in the comment fields, and we'll pray over them as we always do. If you're here and you have a specific prayer request, if you'll write it on the little white cards in the front of you, we'll pray over them. And if just by a show of hands, do you have an unspoken request? Yeah, many unspoken. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, there are people right now in this room. There are people on Facebook. There are people all around us that are struggling with illness, with not only just physical issues, but mental issues and struggles and strife, financial, everything that goes on with what's going on in this world right now. There's hatred and division. That You are the one shining point in our life. That if all of us would focus on You, the world would be a better place. And so, Lord, we take this moment to come near you, to draw our focus in upon you, to ask that you heal those that need healing, that the broken hearts are mended, that hatred is suppressed, that division is united again. May we as a church be a shining example of what it means to be united. You know, as I continue with the Northwest Indiana One Church project, I ask that you take those pastors and that you bring them closer together so that they can be examples to the area, that they can be examples to their churches, and that there becomes this unified voice, this one voice of how great you are. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done. We thank you for what you are doing in this moment. And we so anticipate for what you're about to do. I can't wait to see it, because we know that you have such great plans for us. Let us all say together, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And they all said, amen. Let's stand and worship again.
Took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God always chases me down. Fight till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. You fall, still your love apart from me. You've been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You've been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, reckless love of God.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, he chases me down, finds till I'm found, leaves a 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, till you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God,
Well, have you ever been a foe to God? I love that song. I mean, when we was doing Rise service, it was probably a song we played every other time we was here. You know, he still loved you. That he loved you even when you didn't love him. It's not easy to love somebody when they don't love you, but God did. You know, as we go into this new year, I've been quite honest with you, struggling a little bit in my study. It's like it's not coming as easy as it was for a while. And you go through stages as a pastor where that happens. And I've been praying, and maybe you didn't see Wednesday night prayer meeting, but I mentioned this. I was like 3 hours from prayer meeting to start, and I had nothing. And finally I said, this is ridiculous, Scott. You're going to a prayer meeting and you're not praying that God would help you. And so I bowed my head and I said, Lord, I don't know what to speak about. It's just not there. And I need your help. 5 minutes later, a scripture comes to my mind and I'm able to write my sermon for that evening. And I've been studying this whole beginning of the year about first, like Joshua, and like we talked about last week, how God tells us to be strong and courageous. But I think in the back of my mind, I'm always saying to myself, when you're preaching that, Scott, that there are people that don't feel strong, that don't feel courageous, and it seems impossible to think that they ever would. Is there times when you feel so weak that you don't even know how to go forward? I'm not asking you to raise your hands, but I will tell you there are days in my life that's that way. I like Paul when he says, you know, when I'm the weakest, he makes me strong. Do we believe that? I think one of the reasons that God has chosen me to be a pastor is that I exemplify weakness. There are weeks that I wonder how I will be able to even give a message at all, and yet that he works through me somehow and at least something comes out. Perhaps he uses the weak so that we recognize it's not them, it's him. As we start this new year, I want to encourage you with this thought. It's not our strength, it's not our courage, it's not our boldness, it's not our ability, it's not our skill that God wants. He can give you all of that. In fact, the three words that I want to use for as we start out this new season, as we start to talk about, you know, how do we find strength, how do we find courage, is that how God inspires us, how he gives us clarity, and how he guides us through all circumstances. Today I'm going to be speaking on the inspiration of Jesus Christ. And the title of my sermon today is Being Moved to Move. Let me say that again, because Jeanette said that was confusing when I said it to her. Are you moved? Are you stirred up? Are you excited? Are you inspired? Are you motivated to act? To move? See, Jesus Christ was not just about, here's some great words to live by. You know, here is this wonderful saying, love thy neighbor as yourself. No. He not only spoke these beautiful, powerful, world-changing words, but he did them. He acted them out before us. He was a shining example of what it meant to love others, to put others above himself. That is inspiration. Inspiration is when we are moved by something, by someone, to the point that we are willing to move. Jesus gives us all kinds of commandments. Do, go, love. I mean, love is not a noun in Jesus' words. Love is a verb. It's an action. And so when we talk about, you know, how Jesus inspires us, I believe he takes us from these beautiful words and helps us move into the actions that these words require and demand. Are you being moved to move? There was these, especially in the 90s, I think you still see them somewhat today. There were these bracelets and these t-shirts and buttons, and all of them said WWJD. Perhaps many of you owned one or multiples of them. What would Jesus do? And people would say, well, if you don't have an answer, WWJD. What would Jesus do? And because of that, there was this movement, and you, especially among college students and churchgoers, you would hear this often. It actually was so popular, it actually sort of made it into the mainstream media. And you would hear every once in a while, you know, WWJD. But though as popular as that was and how strong as that was, And as important as it is to consider the words of God, to consider what Jesus had said, what he said you, what he would do, perhaps the bracelet or the button or the t-shirt would have been better WDJD. What did Jesus do? You see, for every teaching that Jesus had done for us, had given us through the gospel, there is a corresponding action that is demanding of us to ask ourselves, well, if he did it and we are following him, should we not do it? WDJD, what did Jesus do, should inspire us, because his words were not supposed to be just good sounding. They were supposed to motivate us, to stir us up, to do the righteous things that God wants us to do, that he wants us to place in importance. If it was all about just good words and not good actions, this world would not have changed. But what you find is that if we are truly following him, if we are truly seeking him, if we are allowing him to invade into our lives, to have heart surgery on our broken hearts, what you will find in that is that it starts to make us, by moving us, so that we will start moving. Christianity without action is hollow. Basically what James writes, he says, you know, faith without works is hollow. He's not saying works save you. What he is saying is this. He is saying, if when you see what Jesus has said, if when you see what he has done, if it does not inspire you, if it does not move you at the very depth of your heart, then you don't get what Jesus was saying. Love thy neighbor as yourself. It's wonderful words that can be on a Chrysler commercial. But when you watch Jesus live it out in front of you and demand a righteous love, it changes things. Do you love like Jesus? Is it even possible to love like Jesus? Those are the questions we should start to be asking. It's not whether or not we should love. It's not whether or not love defeats hate. All those are great platitudes. I've put them out here on our sign all the time. They have no value if you're not moved to move. What did Jesus do? Let's examine an example of that in the scripture, where first Jesus tells us what we should do, and then he shows us what he did. Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 and 22 is where we're going to start our scripture reading today. This is the words of Jesus. Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Now, seven times is a big number. I want you to think about that for a minute. Some of us, and I will say in my past, I was one of them, do me once, I'll forgive you. Do me twice, forget it. I'm out. You're not going to lie to me again. You're not going to treat me bad again. I'm not going to let that happen again. Let alone five more times after that. But Jesus says, seven. I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. You see, what he is teaching Peter, and through Peter teaching us, is that we're to forgive often. We're to forgive always. And we're to forgive whether we want to forgive or not. That as Christians, it becomes a mandate. If you're supposed to forgive 490 times, was my Germantown math right? 7 times 70? I think that's 490 times. If he's saying, hey, 490 times you need to forgive that person, it becomes a mandate. It becomes a command. It becomes more than just, hey, you should forgive. It's easy to tell somebody to forgive. It is hard, nearly impossible to forgive. There are people sitting in these pews today, watching on Facebook right now, that harbor unforgiveness, that are carrying it with them wherever they go. And yet Jesus said, 490 times you should forgive. Now, what if we get to 491? In the Hebrew language, in the Greek language, often they use a number that's so big in their mind that it means every time. Jesus is really saying is you need to forgive often, you need to be ready to forgive, and you must always forgive. And he could have stopped there, and we could have like sat here and said, well, that's a wonderful thought, and you know, yeah, that makes some sense. But perhaps what would happen then if he had done that, perhaps what we would have seen would be something like, well, yeah, I think he's right, but obviously there are circumstances where I don't have to forgive. Like there are circumstances where this could lead is, well, all we had was words, some of us could interpret and say, well, yes, in most cases you should forgive. In most cases. But not for that. Most cases, yeah, I agree with Jesus. You should forgive. But there are some horrible things that you can't expect me to forgive. Now, I know none of you think that way. But perhaps by reading that 7 times 70, we're looking for the 491st issue so that we don't have to forgive any longer. When it is impossible, it would be easy for us to take his words and to construe them in such a way that says, except for that. Do you have a that in your forgiveness book? I can forgive anything except for. Now look, it doesn't mean, and I always feel like I have to say this, but it's I think it's understood, but I always like to say this for clarity. It doesn't mean if somebody is beating on you or somebody is doing horrible things to you that you have to let them continually do that. What it means is that you forgive them through God so that you do not have to carry that unforgiveness any further. It doesn't mean that you have to accept bad behavior. It means that you are willing to forgive through the love of Jesus Christ. The greatest example, and I've used it before, there was a man whose child was shot by another man. And he went to the court and plead for the guy not to be executed. He said his Lord and Savior would not want that. I've seen example after example in our courts of people speaking up for people that deserved condemnation, that was willing to forgive because our Lord Jesus Christ. There are what seems to be those impossible unforgivable moments in our lives. But WDJD, what did Jesus do? What I find amazing when we read Luke 23:34, as Jesus is hanging on the cross. Now, if Mel Gibson had any, if he was even close to what had happened in the Passion, if you could use that just to somewhat be moved by what happened. I mean, he was beat near to death. He was bleeding. There was ribs sticking out. He was hanging on the cross. He was being mocked. He was being abused. He was abandoned. He was isolated. He was betrayed. Sound familiar? Here's what Jesus said. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And yet still, they were dividing his garments and casting lots. What did Jesus do? Whenever I ask myself, how can I forgive that? I always put myself back at that moment and say to myself, if he was willing to forgive in that moment, let alone that he was willing to do it for a foe, a person that did not, he didn't even, I didn't know him, I didn't love him, and yet he did it still. What did Jesus do? He forgave. He forgave. See, that righteous forgiveness is what is inspirational to me. It allows you to be strong and courageous even in the most unforgivable moments. There's a lot going on right now. If this world would start to have this righteous forgiveness on their heart, if they would allow Jesus to guide them, this would be a better place. This place, inspired by Christ, inspired by what he did, WDJD, what did Jesus do? We would be better people if we could just forgive like Jesus did. What I love about Jesus is that he always spoke in theory but put it in practice. And one of the things that I sometimes think that maybe my sermons are too hard, or maybe they're too verbose or whatever that word is. But here's what I know for sure, is that if as Christians, as a church, we started doing what Jesus did, this little community would be stronger and more courageous. If we would start doing what Jesus did, this community around us would become stronger. And I think you could extrapolate that out to the world. Let's look at another example. Matthew 20, verses 26 to 28. So his disciples have asked him this question. You know, we think of them, these apostles and these disciples, as these great people. These people that, you know, we put them up on these pedestals, or these saints. And yet, the sons of Zebedee ask, hey, aren't we the greatest? Shouldn't we be on the right and left hand of you because we're your best? We're number one? And Jesus responds this way. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever desires to be the first among you, let him be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. What a lesson. Can you be humble? There's the old country song, "It's hard to be humble if you're as great as me." I know that's not the exact words, but that's sort of the theme of the words. Are you selfless? Are you not ever motivated for selfish needs, selfish wants? Do you look for the benefit of others? Are willing to serve others? Are you willing to serve others so that the kingdom is edified, so the kingdom will grow? Jesus is saying that if you want to be a kingdom dweller, that's what greatness is, right? As Christians, what we would say is great is that we are kingdom dwellers, that we are going to live in the kingdom of God now and forevermore. That when we accept Jesus into our lives, we become kingdom dwellers. And Jesus says, if you want that, then serve others. When's the last time as a Christian that you chose to benefit others over yourself? When's the last time that you chose to benefit the church before yourself? When's the last time have you chose to benefit your community, to benefit your country over yourself? Can you be that selfless? And Jesus says, there's a great reward in that. There's a great reward not only for you, but for those around you. I say this often, if people that live around you that know that you are a Christian, which they should, if they do not feel blessed, I ask you, are you moved to move? Are you moved to move? So WDJD, what did Jesus do? Now, I just want to say this before I read these verses. Let's all remember that when we talk of Jesus, we are talking about God. We are talking about God, the sovereign God, the Almighty, that we cannot even comprehend his thoughts or his power. And yet, John 13:12-17. So when he had washed their feet, taken his garments, and sat down again, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." I want to make sure that we understand one thing about foot washing. You know, like if the church, if we would, and I want to so bad, and was really sort of preparing last year that we would do something on Good Friday that would have been a foot washing service. For some of you, that would make you squeamish, just the word foot washing. To have to touch somebody else's foot is, for some of us, a little squeamish. But if I had given you enough notice, most people's feet would be clean, perhaps perfumed, and pedicured. And so touching their feet would be one thing. But understand, there was no forewarning that Jesus was going to wash their feet. In fact, Peter, like, well, you're not washing my feet, Lord. I should be washing your feet. Their feet was in the muck and the mire of the world that day. That the reason their feet needed clean is because they were dirty. And yet our God bowed down before them and washed their feet. Do you understand what he was trying to do in his action for us? He was saying that the worst of the world, no matter how dirty it is, that I am willing to humble myself enough to bow down and wash your feet. If we understand the symbolism of it, it is exactly what God did when he sent Jesus to this earth. God humbled himself and came down to this earth to wash away the muck, the dirt, all the decay and hopelessness. And that is the example Jesus gave us when it came to being a servant. I think about that often when, not the last time I was in Haiti with our church group, but the previous time I was down there, we washed the feet of all the Haitian pastors. There was like 20 of them. We bowed down before them. For them, it made them feel uncomfortable, because as much as we struggle with racial issues here, they still believe that there is a difference between white people and black people. In Haitian terms, it's still that real. And for a white man to bow down before a black man and to wash their feet was beyond what they could handle. Some of them cried. Some of them would not do it. I say that for this reason, is that when Jesus is trying to move us, to inspire us, to motivate us, to serve others, he does it in a way that for most people, it was something that meant a lot. He does it in so many other ways, but the foot washing to me exemplifies this thought. Are you willing to put aside yourself, to put yourself to the side, yourself, and say, I am going to become a servant of Jesus by serving others? What did Jesus do? He taught us that our humbleness, our willing to serve, is righteous and good. These are only two examples that Jesus used. If you read the four Gospels, if you read some of the epistles that talk about what Jesus did, what you're going to find is he said a lot of things. What would Jesus do? But then his actions backed up his words. And I ask you today, do your actions back up your words? Are you moved by what Jesus has done and is doing in your life? Are you moved? Is your heart moved in such a way that you are willing to move? That is inspiration. Let us not be inspired by things of this world, but let us be inspired by the King of all creation. I'm going to pray here in a minute, and if you want God to move you, if you want Him to help you to move, then I ask that you pray with me. I ask that you see the importance of that. Allow Him to inspire you. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank You for sending Your Son to motivate us, to inspire us, to not only speak good words, but to speak, to walk those words out in front of us, to act on them. May they move us. May they inspire us to move for You. Lord, if there is those that may be praying with me now to be stronger and courageous in this area, I ask that You bless them and that You encourage them and that You let them know that You are there with them. Begin a work inside of them that is amazing, not only to those around them, but to them, themselves. May they know that You are a real God, a God that has all these possibilities for us who seem to have just limited possibilities. Jesus can make so many great things from it. I pray with them. I pray myself that You move me, that You break my heart, that You make it so that I move more and more for You. We thank You, Jesus, for Your inspiration. And we pray in Your powerful name. Amen.
Direction is everything. When the chips are down, when times get tough, when the outcome seems uncertain, we tend to lose our way. We lose sight of the goal. We forget our purpose. Sometimes all it takes is one person to step up, to push through the fear, to encourage the team, to lead the way. Direction is everything.